Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. The decree and predestination, a very important topic. The reason why is because we are speaking about Allah Almighty. And this in itself is a very dangerous topic, a minefield. Because an error, a tiny error, can lead someone to not believe in Allah. And if that happens, then the speaker or the preacher or the teacher or whoever that is will be held responsible for the tiny piece of information that is wrong. This is why this topic here, I looked into it and I wanted to do it in one session, but that would be absolutely untrue, because there are so many subjects and so many topics linked to it, historically and even eventually with the texts themselves, how people did read them and the impact of those texts. Because the way things are going now and the way they have been going on for centuries is that everything that happens on earth is happening because Allah had predecreed. So in other words, we are only following what has been already decided by Allah, and there is nothing much we can do to change that. This creates a problem. This problem exists in non-Muslims and within our community as well, when they ask questions such as, if God existed, if Allah loves us, if Allah is just and fair, why are children suffering? Why are there wars? Why are people dying for no sins of no mistakes of theirs? Why are people, for example, drugged into drugs and then they get addicted by the cartel? So these people will do everything in their position to feed their addiction. And the examples are absolutely unlimited. For example, you take the example of the war. Wars, wherever they happen, in Syria, Yemen, has Allah predecreed that Saudi armies would bomb Muslim children just because they happen to be on a bus or to happen to be happening in a building? And then when you look at the atrocious, terrible, murderous pictures, you go, oh, this is what Allah has predecreed. I hear people, they get married to someone and then their lives becomes a living hell. And when we Muslims advise them, this is maktub, this is what Allah has written. Has Allah truly written that a Muslim should live in hell? Is this what it is? And again, when the Muslim makes dua, they will tell you it is Allah who has written for you to make dua so to get you out of hell. Is this how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala works? Is it what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala truly say in Al-Quran? And if not, why do we have such beliefs? Why do we believe like everyone else is maktub, it's written? Even the Arabs, they have this saying. They say, ما هو مكتوب بين الجبين تراه العين. Whatever is written between your on the forehead, your eyes shall see it. It will happen. Whatever, even in the English culture, in the world culture, they say whatever is written shall come to pass. And what has been written really? Are there things that have been written on us and we cannot escape them? Or do we have 100% free will to do as we please on earth, then meet Allah on Judgment Day to be held accountable and responsible for what we have done? Now, the preaching as it goes now, you see, the problem with us, subhanAllah, is we say something and we act something. We say some Muslims act, any Muslim scholar, ask them, and they will tell you, no, Allah has given you 100% choice to do as you please. And you go, that's fantastic. And then, for example, you bring a hadith that says that when Allah, and this hadith is authentic in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, and I will deal with it in this series, inshallah. And when we say, Rasulullah says that Allah, when He created all humanity, He divided them into two groups. On one group, He said, these are destined for paradise and I don't care. And the other ones, the other half, is destined to hellfire and I don't care. And believe it or not, this is an authentic hadith and it presents a final concept in our belief. This is why in Ramadan, people, you hear them making dua, especially in Mecca and all these duas that have been recorded. They say, Ya Allah, if you have written me of the people of hellfire, please remove my name and put it in Jannah. And this to me sounds, subhanAllah, Allah in the Qur'an doesn't say this at all. So why have we abandoned the teachings of Al-Qur'an and moved on to other topics, hadith or the sayings of the scholars, and these are what represents the belief in the decree and predestination today? Another example that will help us understand this concept here. We say that every time when a baby is born, Allah sends an angel. You know the hadith in Muslim and Al-Bukhari, and it's also in the 40 hadith of An-Nawawi. All what I'm saying now is really give you a heads up on what's happening in the series. I will discuss all what I say here and more when I get the opportunity, inshallah, in the talks. So the famous hadith here about when the baby is born, the first 40 days is a drop of sperm, and then al-mudgha, and then alaqa, anyhow. Then it gets to the 120th day when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it is reported that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, if he had said it, that Allah sends an angel, and the angel blows a soul or ruh into the newborn. And then he writes four things: his life, when he is going to die, his sustenance, his rizq, if he is going to be a happy person or an unhappy person, and the final abode. So the way it is presented to us in this hadith is everything is predetermined. That say, what you are going to get in your life is already written. If you're going to be happy or unhappy has already been written. And then when you are going to die, the day you are going to die is already been written. And also, oh, forget the fourth point, but you get the idea, it's the hadith. So here we have this hadith that sets things straight, that everything is written. But is this what Allah says in the Quran? I'm just going to take one example of these four ones here and give you a hint, a heads up. If Allah has written when we are going to die. Let's say I will die next year, this time of my talk, okay? And then there is absolutely, according to the hadith, there is absolutely nothing for me to avoid. And obviously when Allah writes your death, He will write how you will die. Then if Allah has truly written this, why has He also in Al-Quran ordered that anyone who murders someone shall themselves be murdered? A soul for a soul. You kill, you get killed. If I happen to kill somebody, and if I go to the court of law and they ask me, why did you kill the person? All I have to answer is this: that person was going to die anyway, because Allah has predecreed their death, and the way they are going to die was already predecreed, and I was chosen to carry that decree. So why do you blame me? I am absolutely innocent. It is the decree of Allah. If there is someone to be held guilty for this crime, it must be the decree itself. Because at the end of the day, take the example like this, the television that you have at home is switched off. To turn it on, you need the remote control. You press on the red button and or on the on button, and the television gets to work. Now, if someone comes to the television and tells the television, why did you work? Then the television will turn, don't blame me. I didn't turn up myself. All I did was obey a predecreed protocol to be turned on. So if you really have an issue, go to the remote control. Then you go to the remote control and say, hey, why did you turn on the television? Well, the remote control is going to tell us, don't blame me. Everything that I did is predetermined. And then you ask, who did that? And it points at you, the human. He said, that is the human. And then who is to be blamed here? The television that got turned on, or the human that turned on the television? Everyone within their mind will say that it is the human being. So go back now to the murder. So if someone kills and we ask him, why did you kill? He would say, just like the television, it's not me. Blame the decree. And then we go to the remote control, the decree, and say, why did you decide that this person should kill? The decree will say, I've got nothing to do with this. It is Allah that has written that I do that. And then the whole blame goes back to Allah. If someone commits fornication, let me ask you this, my brother and my sister. If your wife commits fornication, you come home and the crime is done, And then she just turns to you and she goes, sweetheart, there was absolutely nothing that I could have done to avoid this because it is predecreed and it had to happen. It's predecreed. What can you do against it? So would you just turn away, my brother, and say, yes, my wife only carried the will and wish of Allah. She committed zina, fornication, just because Allah had predecreed this. Would you, my sister, accept that your husband commits fornication because Allah has predecreed that? Nobody accepts that. Nobody accepts that. So how can we reconcile between what's being preached and the reality of the truth? And this is where our scholars and the way the decree and predestinations are presented today fail miserably. Because the way the decree and predestination is preached today is the following. They tell you that were once Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. All this I will discuss it in details, inshallah, in the topic as a whole, because I will cover it from all angles. I will speak about the hadith that says that one day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was all alone. And then he created the preserved tablet and a pen. And then he ordered the pen to write. And the pen said, what should I write? Then Allah says, write everything that is to happen until eternity. And the pen got writing. Write. So it wrote the trees, the birds, everything. Then when Allah wrote everything to be created, he left that preserved tablet untouched for 50,000 years. And then after 50,000 years had elapsed, Allah started the creation and he was only reading from the Lawh al-Mahfuz, the preserved tablet, and creating. It's just like you're following a recipe to cook a dish. You read on the recipe, you've got the element, the ingredients to cook, and then you just follow the recipe, what it tells you, and you cook. So here, basically how it's presented, Allah has written the recipe of everything to happen. 50,000 years had elapsed, and then Allah decided to start creation. So he was only reading from the recipe, the book, the preserved tablet, and creation. Is this really true? Does the Qur'an say this? Well, actually, the Qur'an does not say this at all. And also, here is another catch. When they say, and again, I will cover this, inshallah, in the hadith, when I talk about this very particular topic. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I don't believe that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said this. Anyway, but I'm just going to go with the flow. If Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said the hadith, and he said that Allah wrote everything 50,000 years before creation, The only problem with this is when Allah wrote, there was no time. Allah has not created time at all. So how did we come up with that 50,000 years? How did we? You see what I mean? If the time was not created, who told us that it was 50,000 years? Allah, he hadn't created anything yet. So this is the first flaw with the hadith. But anyhow, let's carry on. And then when Allah created everything, I will also talk about, has Allah truly created all of the humanity? And then in one hadith, Bukhari Muslim again, it says that Allah took a half with his hand and he gives these to hellfire. And he took the other one and he says with the other hand and he gives these to hellfire, to paradise, and I don't care. Has Allah really truly carried us with his hands? Because in the hadith, again, which will push me to speak about, does Allah have a physique like you and me? Because every Muslim out there tells you the hearts of people are between the fingers of two fingers of Allah. He turns them as they like. And every people there, they believe that Allah has fingers. Allah does not have fingers. Okay, it's a figure of speech if Rasulullah had said it. I will speak about the influence of Jewish traditions and hadith and the Bible on this text. You'll be surprised how many hadith we think Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said them. We think that Allah said them when in fact have been said, but you find them in the Bible text for text. It's unbelievable. I'll just give you an example, yeah? In one of the hadith, it says on the day of judgment, where Allah will tell the servant, Abdi, my subservient, I was sick and you did not follow me, and you did not visit me. And the person will say, Ya Allah, how could I have visited you when you are Rabbul Alameen, the Lord of the universes? Then Allah will tell him, if you had visited my subservient who was sick, XYZ, a person who was sick, you would have found me with him. Then Allah will tell the person, I was hungry and you did not feed me. Then the person says, Ya Allah, how can I feed you and you are the Lord of the universe? Then again, the hadith says that Allah tells him, if you had gone to so-and-so of my subservient who was poor and you had fed them, you would have found me with his. I think you've heard this hadith and you know it. Well, guess what? This hadith exists exactly in Matthew 15. If you go in the Bible and you open Matthew and then you go to chapter 15, you will find Jesus, son of Mary, alayhi salam, as the Bible claims, on judgment day. He will tell people that were in his city, and he would tell them, I was sick and he did not visit me. And they will say, of course, talking to Jesus, how could we have visited you and you are the son of God, things like that. Then Jesus tells them, if you had visited the person, you would have found me there. So the text of the Bible got exactly transmitted to Bukhari and Muslim as a hadith Qudsi, as a divine hadith. And now we believe that on Judgment Day, Allah will ask us, I was sick and you did not visit me. This is just one of many, many, many texts from the Bible, either the Jews, the Old Testament, or the New Testament, that found their way in Islam. Also, I will speak about the influence of Christianity and Judaism on the belief of the decree and predestination. Because the Qur'an, and I'll give it to you flat out now, the Qur'an says that we humans are 100% free to do as we please on earth with the tools that Allah has given us. For example, yeah, the tools of your hand is to work with your hand, and you know what you can do with your hand. Your hand will never ever eat. You can't put your hand and eat with it. You eat through your mouth. So the eating of your mouth, the color of your eyes, the genes that you carry in your body, your height, the way you are, and all those things that you do not have control, that you were born with, Allah has predecreed them for you. But you getting fat is not something that Allah has written on you. It is you who eat a lot of rubbish and you are fat. Can you lose that fat and become healthy again? Of course you can. But can you use your eyes and turn it into an eating device, i.e. you eat with your eyes and you hear with your mouth and you speak with your ears? Of course you cannot. Because Allah has not written that your ears should speak. So this is a tool that Allah has given us. And then we will speak about the light of Allah that Allah had bestowed upon humanity, as they claim. That Allah Ta'ala, when He created the humanity, He shed His light upon us. Anyone who was touched by that light shall go to paradise, and anyone who was not touched by that light will go to hellfire. And I will explain why this is such a flawed concept. Because this is in a hadith, when in Al-Quran, Allah has mentioned in over 500 ayah in Al-Quran, where Allah says that humans have free will 100% to do as they please, and that Allah wa ma rabbuka bidhallamin lil'abid, that Allah will not oppress his subservient in any way. When we are born, every human is given equal opportunity to carry on his life or her life to the best of their abilities. No one can come on judgment day and tell Allah tabaraka ta'ala, Ya Allah, I could have been better, but you have limited my abilities when you wrote my pre-decree and you made me a loser. Can someone say that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on judgment day? Of course not. Then if we can't say this to Allah on judgment day, we cannot use that argument of it's written. And I will explain the ayat in Al-Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَانَ أَمْرُ اللَّهِ مَفْعُولًا, and the command of Allah was to take a place. And I will explain also the creation of our actions. Has Allah created our actions ahead of us, or do we create our actions as we go along? we will also see and go back all the way to the creation of our father Adam. And it's not going to be about the how Allah created him and everything, but to that fateful day where Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala told the angel, Inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa. I am going to make a inheritors in on the earth. So what that means and how does that apply to us today, and the debate that went between Allah and the angels, and also between Allah and Satan when Satan refused to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam. And what has Allah truly given us on that day? I will also speak about the topic of, is Adam alayhi salam our father the first man on earth, i.e. no humans have existed before him, or has other humans existed before Adam, and Adam was the newcomer in a new series of humans? Because the Quran speaks about the latter more than the first, i.e. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Adam is only a follow-up in the series of creation. He is not the first human, and we'll go and speak about the different ayat that speak about that. I will also speak about Judgment Day. It's a really a comprehensive topic. And also, and more importantly, I will speak how we deviated from the topic of the decree and predestination that was preached at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he came to Quraysh and then he migrated to Al-Madinah, no one has ever used the decree to fight Rasulullah. No one has ever told our messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam that we don't believe in you because Allah has said and pre-decreed that we shouldn't believe in you. And that would have been a sufficient argument to win everything against Rasulullah. But subhanallah, Allah in Al-Quran sent Al-Quran and said to the Prophet, do this and do this and do that, help people find me and all that kind of stuff. Why would Allah do that when he already had predecreed that every people who wouldn't believe in him and who would believe and how they would believe in the messenger? This makes no sense. Also, I will speak about Allah knowing the future and knowing the unknown. هُوَ اللَّهُ الَّذِي لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ عَالِمُ الْغَيْبِ وَالشَّهَدَ. It is Allah. There is no other deity but Allah, and he is the knower of the unseen. I will give you an example, yeah? You are two people. You go inside the room and you hide an expensive watch. You hide it somewhere where no one would find it. And then you go out to people and you boast. You go, you know what? I know exactly where that watch is. And then you go and get it out from the place, and people will look at you and you go, there is no big deal. It's you who put it there. Why should you claim that you know what it is? You see what I mean? However, if someone else hides this the watch in a specific room, a place, and then you go to people and you have no clue where that watch is, but you tell people, I know exactly where that watch is, and you go exactly to the spot and you get the watch out of it, then people will start believing that you got superpowers to make you do that. Of course, humans can't do that, but it's just to illustrate an example. The same thing for Allah. If Allah had predecreed everything as it is claimed, that Allah has written everything, minute, big, atomic, everything is already on the preserved tablets, what's the big deal about Allah telling us that he knows the unseen? What's the big deal? You already decreed everything. You know everything ahead of time. So you've wrote it. So what's the big deal? But actually, there is a big deal. Because there are certain things that Allah has not predecreed. Of those things are our actions, you and me. Allah has not predecreed what we are going to do. And then he knows what we are going to do, but he has not predecreed them. And this is the power of Allah. You understand that? And I will explain this in Al-Quran. That's why at the end of Surah Luqman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the five things that only him knows. Of those things is when Al-Ghayth, the rain, will exactly fall. Because saying that Allah has written everything ahead of time, the Quran actually negates that. Al-Quran challenges that concept. Because Allah says, in so many ayat, in abundant great number of ayat, Allah knows what they plot at night. Allah knows this. Allah knows that. Why does Allah say all this? Because it is not written ahead of time, which brings me to speak about the great topic of, are our actions created by Allah ahead of time, or do we create them? And what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says? وَاللَّهُ خَلَقَكُمْ وَمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. And Allah created you and that which you do. This ayah has been also misunderstood by a great number. Now someone can say, a great number of scholars. So someone might say, how come all these scholars have missed the point, and you suddenly out of the blue come and say that actually it's not me? Because remember always one thing, my brother. The scholars that you are aware of today are specific scholars of a specific school of thought. In the way Islam is presented today, the one that is preceding the whole entire world, is the Islam that is supported by Saudi Arabia because of the wealth, and also because Mecca and Medina happen to be in this country these days. Now, people have that kind of impression, because it comes from Mecca and Medina, it must be true. And because Saudi Arabia spent a lot of money to promote its ideology, Islamic ideology, which served politics more than anything else, but they spread that ideology because it's a school of thought ideology. 99% of what Muslims believe today, especially in the West, comes from that ideology. If I asked you, name me 10 scholars from the Hanafi school of thought, you wouldn't be able to. Name me 5 scholars from the Maliki school of thought, you wouldn't be able to. But if I say, name me 20 scholars from the Hanbali school of thought, you would be able to, because this is what's hammered in our days in out. Different school of thought have different issues, different views, different beliefs about the decree and predestinations. And the good news is, I am going to mention all these school of thoughts. Al-Qadariya, those who use the decree as an excuse. They do absolutely nothing. You ask them, they say, hey, Allah has written this. There is nothing I can change that. And also Al-Jabriya, who say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forces humans to do certain things. And then I will speak about the Mu'tazila, which to us today, every time you hear Mu'tazila, you cringe. You think like they are vile people, evil people, deviated people, when in fact they are not. Wallahi al-Azim, they are not. But the animosity between the Hanbali school of thought, that is today, as I said, marketed by Saudi Arabia, and the Mu'tazila, is what, because the Hanbali make the Mu'tazila vile, especially with what took place between Ahmed ibn Hanbal and the Mu'tazila in his time about the creation of Al-Qur'an. And for your information, I will also discuss that topic because it's part of the Decree and Predestination. And both of them, Al-Mu'tazila and Ahmed ibn Hanbal, were wrong about the creation of Al-Qur'an. Because in Al-Qur'an, not everything that is in Al-Qur'an are the words of Allah. You see, when you see something happens, for example, you go to work and you see an event took place. Someone dropped some coffee on a cat. Yeah, just an example. When you go home and you tell that story to your kids, oh, I saw today somebody dropped coffee on a cat. Now, what have you done? Is that your own words, or you're narrating something you saw or you witnessed? Well, you're narrating something that you witness. And if you, and then you tell them, and the owner of the cat got angry and said to the coffee owner, why did you do that? The coffee owner said, sorry, I did not pay attention. End of it. Okay, I'm just... So when you say to them, to your kids, oh, the cat owner said to the man, why did you do that? And the coffee man said, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't pay attention. Are these your own words, or are you reporting what the other people have said? Now, it's obvious that you just reported. Well, in Al-Qur'an, it's the same thing. When Allah, for example, reports what Fir'aun said, أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى, I am your God, the Most High. Is Allah, are these the words of Allah, or is Allah reporting to us what Fir'aun has said? Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reporting to us what Fir'aun has said. So it cannot be the words of Allah. But to Ahmed ibn Hanbal, sadly, and this is the belief today superseding everything, that everything in Al-Quran from Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Al-Fatiha, to the end of Surah An-Nas, all of these are words of Allah azali, i.e. they are not created by Allah. They have always been there. Allah has always knew that. But this is not true. This is not true. Some parts of Al-Quran are the true words of Allah. And when you look at the whole book of Al-Quran, what Allah has spoken directly wouldn't go beyond 3 to 4 pages. Would you believe that? Most of it, Allah reports what the non-Muslims or those who oppose the belief or Fir'aun or all this, and Allah answers, it's unbelievable. I'll speak more in details about this topic. I'm just giving you kind of the map of what we are going to go. And I will also take the example of when the United States dropped the atomic bomb on Hiroshima and Nagasaki back in the Second World War, back in the 1945 and Second World War. And I will take that example as the core example to illustrate the decree and predestination. Because if Allah had predecreed everything, so the United States had only carried the decree of Allah to bomb those people in Nagasaki and Hiroshima. Which brings us to the question is, what is the sin? What have the people, the civilians that were just going about their business, daily business, what is their sin to endure the atomic effect and torture of the atomic bomb? And as such here, then Allah has certainly zalim. Allah has oppressed these people because he has punished people that don't deserve to be punished. Is this the truth? And I will then take that example and will say, for example, yeah, the Mu'tazilas, this what would the Mu'tazila would mean by that. And this is what the Hanbali school of thought would say, that what is the Qadari people, the decree people, and those who say we are forced to do what we have to do would say. So I give the example from all different angles, so you start getting the idea. And for your information, what you know today as the authentic Salafi Islam is nothing else, and I will repeat it, is nothing else but the Hanbali school of thought packaged as and repackaged as the true Sunnah people and the closest to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This is just a claim, and the people that are today adult Muslims have been brought up on such a claim, and as such it's very difficult to have them see the other side of the coin. The Maliki school of thought that is practiced in North Africa from Morocco all the way to parts of northern parts of Egypt and also in the Middle East, the Maliki school of thought follows around the world, refuse the version presented by the Saudi as being the Sunnah people. The Hanafi school of thought refuses that. The Shafi'i school of thought refuses that. And even the people of Al-Hadith, as in Al-Albani and so on, they refuse this concept of what's being preached by Saudi Arabia is the authentic Islam. It's got nothing to do with the only authentic Islam, as I said it before, it's what's in Al-Quran and Al-Quran alone. And then comes the practice of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Hadith that do not contradict Al-Quran. If whatever, for example, yeah, if Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says Allah created humans and then he sheds his light upon them, whoever was touched by the light of Allah will go to paradise, and whoever is not touched by Allah will go to hellfire, it makes the whole issue as a chance, a luck. If you are chanceful and you are lucky, then and the light of Allah got to you, then guess what? You're going to go to paradise no matter what. And because of this wrong concept came another hadith which makes you really always worry, is that a person acts the actions of the hellfire people until death is far away from an arm length from him. And then he does one act of the people of Jannah and he dies on that act. And guess what? He will go to paradise. And while another one will all his life do the work of the people of Jannah. And then when death is away from an arm length from that person, they commit a sin or they make an action that deserves hellfire and they die on that, then they go to hellfire and that's it. What this means is, let's say a Muslim has always, mashallah, prayed and did their very best until hoping to die and meet Allah on good terms, right? And then, let's say this person gets to 60 years of his age or her age, and then they go through a very great shock. I don't know, the family, their family got killed and the kids abandoned the family and then they lost their job and then they got cancer and i.e. everything goes belly up. Nothing works for them. And in that state where everything is lost, the person became extremely weak. And I'm just going to give you an example. And then they go, you know what? I can't bear this anymore. And then they look right and they go, a bottle of whiskey would do a good job at making me believe what I'm going through. And then the person drinks a bottle of whiskey and dies because of that. Then according to our belief as Muslims, according to what the hadith says, then this person is doomed for hellfire because they died on a bottle of whiskey. Is this really the justice of Allah? Of course not. So why does this hadith taking prevalence over the Qur'an is because the majority of Muslims today do not know what exists within the Qur'an. Wallahi al-azim. Let me ask you a question, yeah? When was the last time you read al-Qur'an? You sat down and read al-Qur'an. When was the last time you took pen and paper and studied 2 pages in al-Qur'an? Muslims today have become like Christians. They don't know what the Qur'an contains, just like the Christians do not know what the Bible contains. Christians knows bit and here, bit there, little bit here, little bit there. Muslims, exactly, they do the same thing. Muslims have no idea whatsoever what goes inside the Qur'an. I will also, as I said earlier on, speak about the influence of Christianity and Judaism. Subhanallah, and you will be amazed how the Al-Qur'an, the centricity of Al-Islam at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Qur'an was the center of Islam. The Qur'an was the heart of Al-Islam. In the time of a Sahaba, Al-Qur'an was the heart of Al-Islam. Then when came the Abbasi dynasty, that is 300 years later, when they wrote down Al-Islam that we have today, when they have formulated and authored the Islam that we have today, Muslims got mingled with different cultures. And I will speak about this in details, inshallah, in the talk that to come. And what happened, as I said, I'm just giving you a heads up of what's coming up. And then when Muslims mingled with the other cultures, when they started preaching Islam, people started asking about Muhammad. Who is Muhammad? Because always remember one thing, the Jews and Christians were in the Arabian Peninsula way ahead of Muslims with hundreds of years. So Jesus and Moses were well known. Moses had miracles, the staff, the snake, all the miracles that the children of Israel had. So when you go and sit down with Jews, and you can do that today, they will talk to you about Moses and you're going to think greatly of Moses because of the miracles that he did and what he endured. When you go speak to the Christians, they will speak to you about the miracles of Jesus, that, you know, turning rocks into food and water and walking on water and turning water into wine and shaping animals with clay and then blowing to them and they become birds. So there are great miracles. So when Muslims were faced with what does Muhammad have as miracles? In fact, the only miracle that Allah gave to our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is Al-Quran. He didn't. So Muslims had to invent miracles. Any miracle that Moses has, they created an equivalent one to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Any miracle that Jesus had, they created an equal for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I will speak about these in details later on and give you real life examples about how Musa alayhi salam was given this and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given that. For example, yeah, Musa alayhi salam in Al-Quran, when the children of Israel were in the open desert and they got thirsty, so Allah commanded Musa alayhi salam to smack a rock, hit it, not like, just touch it with the staff. And then when he did that, 12 springs of water, fountains of water, just sprang out of the rock. And people, each people knew from what to drink. They had marks for each tribe of the children, 12 tribes of children of Israel. And each of them had a mark on which fountain to drink with, because children of Israel were not united. And they all drank from there. Now, Moses has that, so imagine someone tells you that about Moses. Now, you are between two religions, Judaism, and someone claims Islam. So you tell people, what has Moses done? They tell you about the rock, the desert, the water, the stuff, and you go, Ya Allah, that's a big deal. And then you turn to a Muslim and say, and Muhammad, what does he have? Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You go, oh, of course, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has nothing except the Quran. But we invented for them, and you go, oh, for Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he was with the companion in the desert. The children of Israel in the desert, our Prophet was in the desert. Musa alayhi salam was with the children of Israel, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was with the Sahaba. And in the expedition of Al-Yarmouk, there were about 30,000 believers. So you can see the number. Moses hit a rock and the fountain sprang from it, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did better than that. What he did was, is that he pointed his holy hand sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the ground, opened his fingers, and water started running out from between his fingers. And now who wins this competition? Of course it's Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because water coming from a rock, it can happen. It can happen. You can see it. You go in nature, you can see this in springs and things. But pure, fresh, beautiful water coming out from the hands between the finger of a human being is unheard of. And as such, they created a miracle for Rasulullah. And this is one example. And I will give you about 10 to 20 examples on how the different prophets have their miracles and our prophet has his miracle. How Idris alayhi salam in the Bible, when he went in the ascension to the heavens, he went from heaven to heaven. And what prophet he found in the heavens? And it's in the Bible. Well, our Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the night of ascension to heaven, on heaven number one, he saw Adam alayhi salam, heaven number two, he saw three, until he got to the number. It's unbelievable how many texts that we take for granted today are found in the Bible, and both Bible, Old and New Testament. So this will give you an example also about how the decree that exists in the Bible and Old and New Testament and other books had made its way into our Islam. If Allah had written everything ahead of time, if Allah has already decreed where you and I will go, if Allah has absolutely written that I tomorrow will go and be drinking or fornicating, and there is no way for me to avoid that, then why did Allah give us the knowledge to know this? He should have actually taken this knowledge away from us so that we carry what He has already pre-decreed. So that on Judgment Day, we won't win any argument against Him. But since Allah has given us the knowledge to know that this cannot happen, then it will not happen. Whatever you decide to do, you handfully, like 100% responsible for it. Allah gives you the tools, you choose what to do with the tools. A tool is money. When you have 20 pounds in your hand, you can go and buy food, you can go and buy a copy of a book to read, you can go and enjoy something for yourself healthy, or you can buy drugs with them. So the money is the tool. Allah has given you a choice. وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَهَا. And a soul that has been perfected to its creation, and Allah has at the same time given intuition to do good as equal as intuition to do evil. So every time you do good, is you have run away from doing an evil, and you have made a choice. This is what Al-Quran says. So the tools are there for you to make choices. Then on Judgment Day, Allah will ask you, why did you make that choice and not that choice, knowing that in Al-Quran, I have asked you to do this choice. Why did you choose to do the other one? In one time, you have always two options. Let's say someone happens and you need to speak the truth. And on the other hand, you can speak lie. And based on the situation, well, if you have a member of the family, and you know if you speak the truth, the entire family will be your enemies, they will scorch your life, they will hate you, they will never speak to you again. So this is speaking the truth. And on the other hand, you can speak falsehood, and the family will love you, blah, blah, blah. But the other person who was wronged will go wronged. Then Allah tells you, ignore the family, ignore their hate, but you must speak the truth at the cost of anything and everything. كُونُوا قَوَّمِينَ بِالْقِسْطِ شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ وَلَوْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ وَالْوَالِدَيْنِ. Always be the people that speak the truth, that do righteousness, and always witness for righteousness, even against yourselves and your parents, where Allah has commanded us in Al-Quran to be absolutely fantastic with our parents in behavior and how we treat them. But when it comes to the truth, Allah tells you, speak the truth even against your parents, even against yourself. Then at one point when you are put in that situation, the choice is all yours. Should I speak the truth for Allah and hurt my parents who are going to hate me forever? Or should I lie and my parents will love me
and but I will not do what Allah says. What Allah tells you, speak the truth. Ignore the fact that your parents will hate you and do that. Now, you can't, you cannot, on judgment day, come to Allah and you say, Ya Allah, I lied and spoke to support my parents because that's what is already written. That's what you have decided for me. Is that acceptable on judgment day? Of course not. So where did we go wrong? Well, initially, the first centimeter that took us away from the straight path was done by Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, the first king in the history of Muslims until our days. What this man has done, he got into a battle against Ali. Ali, the husband of Fatima, the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and on the household of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Later on, when everything finished after the killing, assassination of Ali, after the assassination of Al-Hasan, son of Ali, and after the assassination of before the assassination of Al-Hussein, because Al-Hussein was assassinated after the death of Muawiyah. But after the assassination of Al-Hasan, Muawiyah became king. Al-Hasan was poisoned, alayhi salam. The grandchild of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was poisoned. But anyhow, when Muawiyah became the king, Muslims did not accept that because he became king in the Sham, Syria, today. But the rest of the Arab world were not accepted, especially in Al-Iraq and Al-Basra and all these people. They were still anti-Muawiyah. They hated him. And then they told him, how can you become a king when it was supposed to be Ali and so on and so forth? Then Muawiyah started using the machine of religion. He was the first one to recruit scholars. What's happening today in Saudi Arabia, they cannot give a khutbah in Saudi Arabia unless it is issued by the Ministry of Religious Affairs. Okay? When As-Sudais came to England, I think back in 2002 or 3, in one of my meetings with him, because of the job that I had done, I was offered a position in the ministry as a secretary to some secretary person to the Ministry of Religious Affairs in Saudi Arabia. My first question was to As-Sudais was this, because he offered me to, he said, give me your paper and I'll get you to work in Saudi Arabia, amongst other jobs that I was offered. I said, will I be responsible for telling imams what to do, like writing letters and just, he goes, that's part of the, of course he didn't say it straight away, but he said, that's part of the job. It's kind of like to have a hand on what goes on there. I said, I'm sorry, I can't do that. I can't work for a government that tells me what to do. And I said, what if what they want is against the book of Allah? And then As-Sudais told me, then you are now good to go there. And that's how I rejected the post. Anyhow, but anyhow, in Saudi Arabia, I'm telling you this because to tell you I know what I'm talking about when it comes to this kind of affairs and what happens in Saudi Arabia. I worked with them for years. I'm very close to them. I was close to them and I know exactly how they function. So in Saudi Arabia, before every Jummah, the imam in the masjid gets the khutbah and he only can speak what the government tells him to speak. Even recently, last year, in one of the great problems that Palestine was facing, the world was boiling about what happens in Palestine, while the imam in Al-Madinah talks about the four seasons of the year and how Allah has given us four seasons. And this infuriated not only the Saudis themselves, but the world over. How come everyone is talking about the Jews attacking Al-Aqsa when you could have spoken about that and everything like you did before, but now you choose to ignore that because the government told you to choose to ignore that and you're following only the government. Muawiyah did exactly the same thing. He recruited a huge number, about 10,000 of scholars of shuyukh at that time there, and they designed a very specific set of beliefs. The first one of these beliefs is that everything happens with a decree, and if Muawiyah is a king, it means that Allah has wanted him to be a king the day before he created heavens and earth, 50,000 years before creation began. So why do you blame me? And then they invented a hadith, which is in Al-Bukhari, and I will speak also about that hadith, where, I don't say Rasulullah ﷺ said, but I have to because that's what they say, that Rasulullah ﷺ said that Musa one day had an argument with Adam. Musa told Adam, Adam, why did you disobey Allah? Is it you who disobeyed Allah? It is you who Allah created with your hands. It is you who Allah made the angels prostrate to you. It is you who Allah put you in Jannah. It is you. And then he went on and said so many things that already exist in the Quran. And then Musa said to Adam, why did you disobey Allah and kicked us out of Jannah? And then Adam now will retaliate. Adam tells him, are you Musa, son of Imran? Musa says, yes. Are you Musa, the one who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to the children of Israel? Musa says, yes. Are you the man who Allah gave him the staff? Yes. Are you the man who Allah opens the sea for him? Yes. So Adam, in his respect, goes and tells Musa all the bounties that Allah gave to Musa. And then Adam says something here, which I am willing to put my life and my neck under the guillotine, that neither Rasulullah ﷺ had spoken that, nor Adam ﷺ had spoken that, but we Muslims believe in, and I used to believe in that. When Adam said to Musa, yeah, Musa, did you read in the Torah? And I want you to pay attention here. Did you read in the Torah that Allah had decided to put me on earth 50,000 years before he created everything? Then Musa said, yes. And then Rasulullah allegedly said, and that is how Adam beat Musa in the argument, how Adam won the argument. That belief came to us today. Yeah, repackaged in differently, but that is exactly the same belief. If Muawiyah is king of Muslims, it is because Allah had decreed this gazillions of years, 50,000 years before creation. And to make that a true belief, the scholars had to invent so many things. Those things are being taught until today, that Allah knew everything. So he wrote everything to happen. So the first element is Al-Kitab, the writing of everything to happen. Okay, so Allah knew everything, wrote everything. The third pillar is the will, that Allah willed for something to happen. And they say, that's why you say inshallah, when in fact inshallah has nothing to do with that. And the fourth thing is creation. So according to Muawiyah, Allah knew that Muawiyah will be the king. Allah wrote everything. And he wrote that Muawiyah shall be king on that year. And Allah has wanted Muawiyah to be a king. And Allah has made Muawiyah to be a king. So the bottom line is, why do you blame me? I'm only carrying the decree of Allah. And that's how Muawiyah forced his way into kingdomship. So many scholars have been killed, and I will name few of them. Because history, as I said to you, is always presented by the winner. And what we are getting today is only one side of the history. Our books are still filled with blood that has been shed, so that some of the beliefs that exist today under the banner of Hadith exist more stronger than those in Al-Quran. Al-Quran gives something beautiful. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَ اللَّهِ. As for those who say our Lord is Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah here tells you, if you believe that in Allah and you stick to the right path to do goodness, and this doesn't mean you and I, any Christian, any Jew, anyone out there, and I will speak about this, who is the Muslim, what's the Muslim, the believer, because you need to know all these things, because they affect the belief in the decree directly. So everyone out there who says Rabbi Allah, my Lord is Allah, God, and then they do righteousness, at the time of death, the angel shall descend upon them and shall bring the good news. Allah takhafu wa la tahzanu. Do not be scared and do not be remorseful for because Allah will be نحن أولياءكم في الحياة الدنيا. And then the ayah carries on with good news. To us Muslims today, anyone who doesn't follow the Islam that we have today is a kafir. This is absolutely wrong. The Quran doesn't say that, but these are the teachings of Muawiyah. And then Banu Umayyad, and then the dynasty of Al-Abbasiyah. To have more information on this, please go on my YouTube channel, Islam Pep Talk, and look for a talk that says 14 centuries of history, Islamic history, under 1 hour. I mention certain elements of history there that you need to know. Saying all this, I will also speak about the big issue of, does the dua fight Al-Qadr? And again, the great misunderstanding about this issue, because the mixture is absolutely painful and hurtful. Finally, I'm coming up to the hour. I want to say this. The topic of the decree and predestination is a delicate topic. Not because it's very hard to understand. The Qur'an makes it absolutely clear. We humans have 100% free will. Allah does not interfere in any way in what we do unless we ask Him to intervene on our behalf. For example, if you have an issue with someone or war, whatever, why do we ask Allah to help us against others? Because Allah has a hand on what happens on a daily basis. So many things are not decreed to happen. Allah creates them on every single second of the day. This is why in Surah Ar-Rahman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Kullu yawmin huwa fi sha'n." Every single day, Allah is in a matter of creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates and He changes. You know, for example, yeah, you leave your home at 8 o'clock to catch the train at 8:20. Allah is, as you leave home, He's making you leave home, He's planning, He's doing what your world needs to be done, so Allah does it for you ahead of time. And then at the same time, He makes the train meet you at the station, and at the same time, He makes someone meet you, and He makes, all these things are done by Allah on every split of a second of the day. So many worlds are created. This is why He is a God. It's not like He created everything ahead of time and now He's just relaxing and seeing things happen as He created them. There is no purpose in that. Allah has decreed certain things, but they do not relate to us in any way. Those things that are forced to happen and that are decreed to happen, for example, and Allah had put certain laws in them, is the beating of your heart. You can't control the beating of it. It beats for you, either you like it or you don't like it. But how does the heart beat? It beats related to an equation, to how a set of protocol that Allah has put for the heart, and the heart beats according to that. Now, the beating of the heart is a decreed matter. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran swears by the way when we speak, the sounds that come, وَإِنَّهُ لَحَقٌ مِثْلَ مَا أَنَّكُمْ تَنْتِقُونَ. When Allah spoke about the Quran, Allah says the Quran is the objective truth, as true as the sounds that come from you when you talk. So, you see, Allah gives us a real life example on how we master our talking. And I will also speak about so many different issues, but at the end of the day, I will tell you this, before I start my first topic on this, is what you do in life is 100% your choice. Nothing is written ahead for you. You have 20 pounds, you are going out, you have no clue in what that 20 pounds will be used, but you have it in your pocket, right? Allah knows what you will use your 20 pounds for, but nothing is decreed from you. And I will explain the concept of the endless opportunities with that 20 pounds, what you can do with that 20 pounds. You can buy, you can donate, you can lose them, you can delay their expenditure for the next 60 days. All this you have no clue of, but Allah knows exactly where that 20 pounds is going to go, what it is going to do, how it's going to affect the economy of England, and all the hierarchy of what that 20 pounds can do or cannot do for the world in which it exists. When you and me, we only spend it, Allah knows the endless possibilities of what that 20 pounds can do and where it will land in 60 days from now. That you and I don't know. This is why He is a God, because He has not decreed anything when it comes to our actions as to what we do, but He knows the future and He can alter the future. This is why we make dua. When you get on your car, you don't know if you're going to be having a collision on the road or not, because nothing is pre-decreed yet. And this is why you ask Allah to save you while being on the road. And then Allah accepts that dua, And then Allah will make sure that no one will collide with you on the road. And He makes you avoid this, and you turn that, and you turn that, and you go home safely. And you go home safe and you don't think about it. But really, if Allah showed you, He would have showed you that you asked Allah to help you, and that car there, the red car, which had left 5 minutes after you left your home, but they were driving at certain speed, they were about to collide with you at that point A, in certain point there. But Allah made you turn before you got to that point A. He made you take a right turn, and He made a traffic so that you turn right to avoid the collision with the car you would have met a few yards away from where you were. We don't know this, but Allah sees it and knows it. This is why we always say Alhamdulillah, and we are always thankful to Allah, not only for what we know He did, but we should also be thinking to say Alhamdulillah for what we don't know that He did for our well-being. And believe me, He does a lot. He does a lot behind the scenes as we speak. Just like a movie. You watch a movie, The Jurassic World. I took my daughter to it, and it was a fantastic movie. I encourage you to take your kids to it and watch it. It's beautiful. And once we get into the movie and we are captured by the movie, we forget the special effects. We forget the chroma key, the green backgrounds, and how they remove them and put technical stuff, CGIs and Photoshops and all that kind of. We forget all these things, but to us it's completely different. The dinosaurs become true. The way they eat humans become so true. We kind of like think like these animals are totally true, when in fact it's not true at all. It's just a movie. The same thing, we don't know what goes beyond the scenes that Allah does for us. All it is for us is we enjoy a nice drive and we come home and you go, oh, so a nice tree today. But we don't know what Allah has done to avoid us the evil of the road, to get us safe, to make us see beautiful things and bring us home. That's what Allah does. That's what the decree speaks all about. And that's what we shall be seeing here. I could actually go on and speak for another 5 hours about these topics, but I just wanted to give you a heads up and also link you with something that is coming up, because I don't want it to take long. And until our next inshallah talk, I pray to Allah that you stay in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and be sure nothing is written upon you ahead of time. Everything you do is a full choice of yours. And what you do today, you'll be asked about tomorrow. And the argument of Allah, you have written that on me, I was forced to do it, will not stand on judgment day. It will not be accepted. Allah has already warned us in Al-Quran that it won't be accepted. So that excuse is vile from heads up. Muawiyah was wrong in assuming that he was written as a king. He had changed our beliefs, the beliefs that he had made exist amongst us today, and we have to remove all external beliefs and stick to that of Al-Quran. This is what we will be doing, inshallah, in this topic here. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has beautifully explained the decree and predestination, how he behaved, what he did, what he said, and all this will be covered in this great talk. I pray to Allah that this talk will encourage you to listen to the series that is coming up and help me give you the best of what I can do. And I pray to Allah to help us all become the best of who we can by adhering to the Quran. Because the Quran, inna hadha al-Quran yahdi lillati hiya aqwam, because Allah has said that this Quran will lead us best to the most beautiful of ways. So if the Quran says this is it, then it must be it, regardless of what 1,000 hadith say or 10,000 scholars say. Until my next talk, inshallah, please rest in the mercy of Allah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. If you want to be again part of my group, please do send me a message on WhatsApp on 0787640 8735, or on my YouTube, Islam Pep Talks, or inshallah you can email me also on islampeptalk@gmail.com. Again, this is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.